Because joining us now on the show is Shailendra Kumar, who's director at Narnolia Financial Advisors. Good afternoon to you, Shailendra. We were basically talking about how the markets are looking, and at the end of the day, you seem to see a recent rally that's very much backed on the back of the sort of solid foreign flows that we've seen, the reduced geopolitical concerns that we were looking at earlier, pick up in terms of expectations, I guess, also from the Modi government. How would you describe this as timing for investors who perhaps want to take fresh positions?
See, the rally of 800 points which has happened in Nifty has a characteristic of a start of a new bull market kind of. The leadership is there in the place. The Nifty Bank is continuously providing leadership. The energy stock has rallied also in the initial part of the move in Nifty, and they are now correcting a little bit all the OMC names. And IT, which was cooling off, say, till two, three days back, now has started showing some kind of a positive sign. So good amount of cyclical rotation has also started happening, because after 800 points, you require new set of themes or leaders to come and take the market to the new high. The worry part is the consumption cycle for sure. Nifty auto remains in a bear phase. If you look at the price, how they are behaving, even Nifty FMCG is not showing any kind of uptick as such. So Nifty consumption basket is, you know, the place where you should see carefully if some kind of a slide which can come in the Nifty. Today's softening is surely because of tomorrow we have a holiday and US Fed will come out with the news. So people don't want to carry bigger position. Having said that, for a new investor who has not participated in the market yet, I think it still is a good time to buy into. If you have some kind of a worry on election front or anything related to it, the idea could be maybe you buy, say, 50% right now and wait if you want to wait for some correction or maybe time correction or a price correction. But it's a good point to buy. The worry which is there in the market is known, which is the consumption side. So, but the banking has enough steam left for the Nifty to, you know, go higher from current level, and maybe infra and cement will join the rally on the latter side of this bull cycle.
But where is the action going to come from? Is it going to come from the front lines or the broader markets? The broader markets are taking a bit of a breather. 0.25 percentage point cut coming in both on the mid cap and the small cap indices. But see, year to date, what they've done, about 1% and 3/4 kind of cut coming in on the mid cap universe. And the small cap universe has moved up more strongly, about a percentage point up move coming in over there. But of course, a lot of the action that we've seen in recent times is about a month old. A month to date kind of number is looking like 6 percentage point up move on the mid-cap universe. So let's concentrate on the IT pack as well and see what it's doing in trade. A percentage point up move, and Infosys, of course, is the stock of the day within that pack. It's made an up move of more than 2 percentage points. You're seeing that uptake in trade today. The company's buyback offer is opening today. They're buying back shares worth 8,260 crore rupees. And I should correct myself, the price is 800 rupees a share, not 500 rupees a share that I said earlier. So 800 rupees a share. It's also, like I said, the top gainer on the IT pack. Shailendra, what do you make of Infosys now, now that the buyback offer is on and you're seeing that kind of traction that is building up within the IT space, notwithstanding what we're hearing on a Mindtree? But perhaps that too is pointing towards the opportunities that are building up within the IT sector. How do you think one should pick and choose? Do you go with the larger names, or do you go with some of the mid-cap players where the headroom for growth could be higher?
You see, when it comes to IT, the larger makes more growth, because, you know, once you have a client or a vertical with a $1 million client, or maybe in a particular vertical, if you have, say, 400 million, 500 million kind of a revenue, the chances of you getting more projects is even higher. So the big will keep becoming bigger as far as the IT goes. Barring some niche spaces where mid-cap and a small-cap has a space, that's said. See, after a long time, some part of the IT is growing at 20%, 30% rate, which is digital. And digital is a kind of change in the IT space, the way it was, say, usually in the initial wave of IT, you came from a manual things to automated things. Now, in the automated, from a normal desktop kind of a processing happening, you are going to digital, where your every device of yours is connected, whether you are a bank employee, bank manager, or maybe bank customer in a BFSI space or PDI space. The area where the digital adoption is higher, say media, say consumers. So look at Mindtree, as the name is like right now getting talked because of some different reason. because the Mindtree was in the right segment. It was more into media and more into consumers. And there, the adoption of digital was very high. So the kind of growth in FY18, particularly as first one quarter of FY19, it simply was rising on that wave of digital adoption. Now digital is getting equally adopted in BFSI as a space. So all these larger names, say Infosys, Tech Mahindra, TCS, they all remain strong, high single digit in dollar constant currency revenue growth. The margin is now has stopped falling. And I think the kind of outsourcing, which is a cost to the IT company, once their scale comes in, digital outsourcing will reduce. And the margin expansion will also happen, say, FY21 onwards. So IT remains a strong story. Infosys remains a must-have in a client's long-term portfolio. For Infosys particularly, the valuation differences between IT and TCS, I think somewhere in next 1 year, 2 years, will start converging. And that will make Infosys a outperformer in terms of sector performance.
Okay, let's move away from that and just take a quick look at what we're seeing with an Axis Bank at the moment, because it seems to be that stock is spiking very much. And this is, of course, after you're looking at the kind of brokerage reports you've seen on it. They seem rather bullish on it. If you take a look at where the counter is right now, it is definitely at a point where it's touched a few record levels. And of course, now the stock currently is trading as it is under pressure after all of that. So that, of course, is where Axis Bank has been. Just a little bit more in terms of some of the other sort of trends that we're seeing when it comes to this particular sector. Shailendra, how do I look at this particular, you can, of course, comment on the kind of spike and then pressure that we're witnessing there. But how does one actually play the private bank sector as well as this whole sort of universe of stocks?
Axis Bank has got, re-rated in the market because of the new management coming and giving a very firm outlook on where the return on asset and the return on equity of the bank would be in, say, 2 to 3 year time frame. And that has given a kind of a safety in the mind of medium-term investors. So re-rating is there. See, not only Axis Bank, all the banks which is there in the as a corporate side books, which is a little higher. So corporate lender, you can call it, say, includes Axis Bank, ICICI Bank, maybe even something in the PSU, like a State Bank of India. For these banks, the stress asset level has continuously fallen over the last 3 quarters now, almost the peak of the stress asset with the banks. Over the last 3 quarters, though the NPA was falling, they kept on providing higher provisions in the P&L. So the provisioning coverage ratio is at almost 80%. Remember, when the NPA cycle started in, say, FY13, for most of the banks, even Axis, ICICI Bank, the provisioning was only 40%. And now today, when the stress asset is reducing, the provisioning is 75, 70, 80 kind of for these banks. So that gives you kind of a cushion for the next 1 year, 2 years. So even if some surprise pocket of NPA comes in form of maybe some power assets or maybe some telecom assets, you have a good amount of cushion in the P&L of these banks, which will reduce the volatility of the profit numbers. So this space remains very attractive for investors.
Sorry, there is a certain amount of scratchiness that's come into our audio connection with Shailendra, and we'll try and rectify that. But even while you were talking, Shailendra, I was looking at what's happening in the PSU banking universe today. There too, we are seeing a downtick of around 0.4%. And the kind of rally that we've seen in the banking universe, of course, both these elements within the banking universe have participated, but PSU banks are more so. Today, Bank of Baroda is the lone ranger that's in the green and only by 0.8%. So by a whisker, but the ones that are taking the maximum hit are stocks like J&K, Bank of India, Indian Bank. They are taking a knock in trade today. J&K Bank by around 2%. So BTVI has learnt now that from within the banks that were under the prompt and corrective action framework, there are some banks that are likely to move out of that framework. They are likely to exit. Indian Overseas Bank, Central Bank, they are likely to get some relief, as Meghna Mittal, my colleague, is joining us to tell us about. Meghna, what are you hearing about the PCA framework and the banks that find themselves there? Because we've seen certain exits. Are there more that are lined up? What are your sources telling you?
Yes, that's right. Now, remember at the start of this financial year, there were 11 banks that were under PCA, and with the government giving the recap amount to various PCA banks, as many as five banks has exited the PCA framework, including Bank of Maharashtra and Bank of India. As of now there are six banks that still remain under PCA framework. Dena Bank and IDBI Bank will automatically exit the PCA framework. IDBI after LIC infuses more capital into it, and Dena Bank after the merger gets completed on April 1. Now, post that, four banks still remain under PCA framework. They include UCO Bank, United Bank of India, Central Bank of India, and Indian Overseas Bank. Now, what the Finance Ministry sources are saying that post the Q4 results in May end, depending on how the Q4 results are posted by these four banks, Finance Ministry is ready to give further assistance to the banks that are on the PCA threshold to pull out a couple of banks out of this PCA framework. Now, if we see the Indian Overseas Bank, especially the operating profit is 1466 crore and provisioning is at 2075 crore, though the net NPs are still high, but if the operating profit increases and provisioning goes down in the Q4, Indian Overseas Bank has a good chance of coming out of PCA framework. A part of this, Central Bank of India has also shown a declining trend of losses. In Q3, its loss was at 718 crore. So Central Bank of India also has a good chance of coming out of the PCA framework. So these two banks do show a very good chance of coming out of the PCA framework post it, their Q4 results if they show improvement. The UCO Bank and United Bank of India, however, there is dismal chance of them coming because they're still, as far as United Bank of India is considered, the operating profit is still very low and UCO Bank losses are still high. So apart from these four banks, we could expect at least two of the banks coming out of the PCA framework by May end. That's what the sources are confirming to us, depending on the performance, and the Finance Ministry is ready to give them further assistance.
Okay, thanks a lot, in fact, for taking us through all of that, Meghna, giving us a sense as to what's happening right there. Just want to also bring in what we're seeing on the other hand with the Vodafone idea, because we're seeing how it's approving the rights issue, and that too at a steep discount of around 60% to the current price to raise up to about 25,000 crore rupees. The stock price nosedived after the announcements. In fact, look at where we are right now. Currently, look at the cuts that you're seeing at the moment, about 2% down, but we've also seen 3% lower in trade. Now, the issue is priced at 12.5 rupees per share, including a premium of 2.5 per share. Eligible shareholders will be offered 87 shares for every 38 that are held. The issue will remain open from the 11th of April to the 24th of April. Now, the board fixed the 2nd of April as the record date to determine the eligible shareholders. The issue is expected to aid the company to take on the competition in the telecom space that, of course, has been very much intensified when it comes to Jio right now. Shailendra, we know exactly the story that has, of course, been playing out in the sector here. But are these sort of levels that we're looking at opportunities for long-term players? And what is your overall take when it comes to telecom at the moment?
See, telecom only positive is now that you have only three players market. That's the only positive between the Jio, the Airtel and the Vodafone Idea. You have just three players, so that only gives you a kind of a mental cushion that in the longer run, when the business stabilizes, and right now surely the business doesn't have stability, the ARPU is not getting a structurally rising for any of these names, and data is not getting monetized the way it should with the huge amount of data consumption happening in India. So the idea is business is not in a stability. We don't have a very clarity on trajectory how the profitable balance will come between these three players in the days to come. So as an investor, I don't think an investment case for these names right now, because you don't have a very clearly, you know, what kind of a cash flow will get generated in 2 to 3 years time frame, because you don't have clarity on the revenue side as well as the kind of balance sheet restructuring and other things happening with these names. So I think a word still for telecom.
That's by and large the view, the consensus view that we are getting on the telecom sector, and the reasons are only too obvious for the kind of pressures that they've been seeing, and also surprising to a certain extent considering the demand, how much of our lives are spent on mobile phones and other devices, and for that you need the help of these players. But indeed, right now, it doesn't look very good for the competitive pressures, for the pricing pressures, and indeed the leverage nature of their books. Meanwhile, let's also talk about the automotive sector. The automotive sector today is seeing pressure, 0.8 percentage point. If you look at the BSE Auto Index, and a lot of that pressure is coming in from all across the board. If you look at manufacturers and some of the ancillaries like Motherson Sumi, which is down about 0.5 percentage point, Bajaj Auto, Aisha Motors, Maruti Suzuki, which of course has seen the market leader within the passenger vehicle segment, has been seeing a significant amount of pressure. But when you talk about ancillary players, component makers, Nomura has initiated coverage on Minda Industries. They put out a buy rating on this counter, and they have a target price set of 490 rupees a share. Let's find out why from Bhaskar Pandey, who's gone through this report. He's joining us from our research team. Bhaskar, if you can walk us through Nomura's understanding of Minda Industries, since they've initiated coverage, what exactly are they seeing as an upside? Today, on a down day for the automotive sector, here's a counter that's doing relatively well for itself, 2.5 percentage point gain on the back of Nomura's buy rating on the counter. Tell us why.
Right, so Nomura has initiated a buy call on Minda Industries with a target price of 490, an upside of almost 40%. Now, what do they like in the stock? What they're saying is that the company is a leading tier 1 auto component supplier, and a lot of the potential is seen in the new business segments. Also, premiumization is going to drive a lot of its growth. Now, this premiumization trend is expected to continue and in fact drive 13% revenue growth in the next few years. Also, alloy wheel segment is going to see a CAGR of almost 40% when it comes to its revenues. And putting these things together, we are seeing a revenue growth of almost 18% in the next 2 years and a PAT growth of almost 30% in the next 2 years. So a significant amount of improvement coming in on both the fronts, the top line and the bottom line. Now, this does not include the Harita Seating acquisition, and if it is considered, we would see an upward revision of the FY20 EPS by almost 4%. And they value the stock at 25 times its PE, given the high growth visibility and the improving return ratios. And that is why a huge upside, almost 40%, and a target price of 490.
That's a really big upside, 40% kind of gain. Thanks very much, Bhaskar. Shailendra, do you think that you would tend to go with this perspective on Minda Industries? Despite the kind of pressures that are building into the automotive sector right now when it comes to demand, it's a more or less a consensus view that the ancillary players, they're going to prove more resilient, and they are going to really move ahead before the manufacturers actually do the turnaround story. What's your sense of Minda Industries in case you cover it, or what are your choices when it comes to the component makers in the automotive sector?
See, Minda Industries product portfolio as well as the management pedigree is very strong. So the kind of execution management has done over last 6-7 years particularly, and the balance sheet is, which is in a very proper shape, that gives you kind of a confidence in the longer term visibility of Minda Industries number. Among the auto component name, naturally Minda remains one of the best in class as far as the management and the business is concerned. But the problem is, you know, this thesis that auto component will prove more resilient than the auto, I don't think it's a very strong. I look at the past, all the history. Whenever the auto has gone decline, after some lag, auto component also starts behaving, you know, not that attractive, because none of these players have huge export components. So they are mostly depending upon the local OEM, most of these names. So they also will not provide you kind of a resilience or a kind of a good return in the auto pack. Let's wait and auto, let the auto becomes little better. Naturally, kind of a name Minda is, and the acquisition, I think it appears return ratio accretive. So that is what is giving leg up to the Minda. Management is very strong. But immediately, till auto pack has not stabilized the automobile names, till that time, auto component would be in a range, with some names in auto component maybe underperforming big time with a lag for sure.
Okay, let's move away from that because I want to just point out what we're observing on a Sadbhav Engineering that seems to be very much in top form today, constructing over 3% of gains. IIFL, in fact, has a buy recommendation on this counter.